summer, if I can be gone.
So.
We're gonna be fine.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Well, yeah, be a part of it.
That's a lot of stuff that we can puzzle.
I am no worries.
Buddy.
Hi, how are you, Dana?
I'm great. How are you?
Good.
Sure.
Thank you.
Where are you posting for tomorrow?
We are live now.
It's Eric. Do you want to use your mic now?
It's shocking.
He never.
A Christian. Her talk. But, you know, she said with her family has not told us, and we think family. Yeah.
And I think they'll be.
Gotta be. Yeah. Yeah, well, they have.
Thank you for joining us for our board meeting related to March 22nd. I will call the meeting to order. I first want to just remind our board members that given we are wearing masks and we're here in person, we want to ask you to please project your voices. Speak slowly and clearly and state your name before speaking. This is helpful to those who are participating in the meeting virtually and those listening at home. We will start off with introducing the board members who are here tonight. We'll start at that end. Mr. Kareem, Bob Dream, Sean Hyland, Ann Bauer. Next to me, Katie Morgan, Todd Smith, Bob Husseline, Paul King. We have with us Superintendent Dana Minogue. We have Deputy Superintendent Sherry Syra, and our Assistant Superintendent Lori Ames. And we have a number of guests here with us, the high school and middle school leadership teams. Thank you for being here with us as well. And did I forget anything?
Just Mark Buffington, our Director of Student Services, and Daniel Kurn-Richek, who is head of our nursing services.
Thank you. Thank you for being here. With that, I will start with the approval of minutes.
On motion for approval, Jeff Hyland.
Bob Green.
And we will do a voice vote. Ms. Green?
Aye.
Bob Green?
Aye.
John Hyland?
Aye.
Ann Bauer?
Aye.
Paul Kinney?
Aye.
Bob Husseline?
Aye.
Todd Smith?
Aye.
Katie Morgan?
Aye.
And I am aye as well. With that, we will get to the communications portion of our meeting. I will read this once. We have people here who have signed up to speak to us live. When they come in, we ask that they state their name, whether they are a resident of our district, what school communities they are affiliated with. If they are representing a particular group, we ask them to share that as well. We ask them to speak for 3 minutes or less. And we also want people who come to speak in person to know that the board cannot engage in dialogue with members of the community during the citizen comment act section. Cheryl, do you want to have the first person come in?
The first person speaking tonight is Vicki Schaefer.
Hello, everyone. My name is Vicki Schaefer. I'm a teacher at Clarkston Community School. My address is 1834 Jennifer Street, Madison. I am grateful to work in a district that has prioritized student safety, student staff safety. I know you have all done your best, and I also know people have been awful to you. It takes true strength to be a leader, and I thank you for it. I am here to share my thoughts about the proposed increased in-person learning for grades 5 through 12. If I have learned anything in my 31 years of teaching, it is this. Everyone thinks that they understand what it means to teach or run a school because they have all been a student. Education is one of the few unifying experiences we all have, and because of that, everyone thinks they are experts on how schools should operate. In my 3 decades of teaching, I have watched as the voices of education professionals have been drowned out. Instead, those with the most resources and largest platforms get the most airtime, and what they often have to say seems to matter most. And right now, what they're saying is an incomplete narrative about education. The The current narrative is that virtual education has been an unmitigated disaster for all students. Imagine what that feels like as a teacher to hear on a constant basis. Virtual school has certainly been difficult and challenging, and there has been great disparity as to how those challenges have played out for students and families. But it isn't an either-or scenario. Nothing in education ever is. We have students thriving in this virtual environment, and we have students struggling to gain any traction, and we have everything in between, just like we always do. It's important that we don't base our decision on moving to a four-day in-person model on a singular narrative that virtual learning is non-learning or terrible learning. Think about the message that we are telling students. Let's remember there are stories of resilience, student agency, self-advocacy, time management strategies, critical thinking skills, content mastery, and other positive habits students are learning. The current narrative of schooling is incomplete because we haven't heard from all of our stakeholders, staff, faculty, students, and all families. And if we honor our commitment to equity in this district, then it is absolutely essential that you as leaders take both the time and the space to hear all voices. There is so much that you don't know because I cannot possibly communicate it to you in 3 minutes. But the real problem is that you don't know because you haven't asked, and it's your job to ask all of the stakeholders, not just the loudest. I urge you to slow down and make the effort to proactively engage all voices in this conversation before you make a decision. The pandemic isn't over. Yes, we have started vaccinating our most vulnerable. Yes, all teachers should soon be vaccinated. Yes, we know more than we did a year ago. There is still a lot we don't know, including long-term effects and transmission by unvaccinated people. It is if transmission and safety, however, are no longer issues that warrant considerations. The mitigation strategies we have in place make us safer. They don't make us safe. I realize that from the outside, the equation has become a simple one. Teachers will be vaccinated equals it's safe to bring back all students. But in between, teachers are vaccinated and it's safe to bring back all students is a black box of details that people on the outside have the luxury of ignoring, but the people on the inside don't. I am asking you to start listening to the people on the inside. Thank you.
The next person speaking is Tyler Emmerich.
Good evening, I'm Tyler Emmerich. I reside at 7320 Elmwood Avenue. I agree completely with the prior speaker that I have a completely different spin on things. On Friday, I eagerly read the superintendent's report for increased learning at the middle and high school levels that was published as part of this agenda packet. I'll say that it was very disappointing for me to hear the superintendent talk about having, quote, every intention of being open full-time for all students at the start of next school year, end quote, but yet have a very non-committal stance on continuing to take that next incremental step towards full-time in-person learning this school year. While I don't doubt the superintendent's sincerity of her report, I do take exception to it. The challenges the superintendent laid out regarding increasing in-person learning for middle high school students this semester are valid and very real. Don't want to minimize that. But my concern is that just like the prior speaker said, there are challenges we are going to face next fall. In light of that, I'd like to ask the superintendent, will you still have every intention of being open full-time for every student at the start of next school year if a new strain of the COVID virus takes over? Will you still have every intention of being open full-time for all students at the start of next school year if there's a surge in cases down the UW campus? Do you still have every intention of being open full-time for all students at the start of next school year? We see COVID morph into a seasonal sickness. We still have every intention of being open full-time for all students at the start of next school year. The current level of social distancing and mask wearing recommendations are still in place next fall. My hope is the answer is yes. We have the plans in place, the tools, the protocols in place to provide a very safe full-time learning environment in the fall. My fear is, unless we take the incremental step This semester, the answer will be no, and we will be faced with more virtual and asynchronous learning in the fall. If we don't have the drive and determination to take the next incremental step now, I encourage with any parent to believe that we would jump from 2 days a week to 5 days a week next fall when many of the same challenges will be in play. While we all wish and hope COVID will begin to get a non-issue, it's around to stay in one form or another. The start of the school year next year will not be normal. We need to be planning and practicing now to provide safe, full-time in-person learning. We can choose to either let COVID continue to wreak havoc on our educational system and the lives of our students, or we can be proactive and take another incremental step towards developing safe, robust, innovative solutions to provide that critical in-person learning. While vital during the initial phase, and while it works for many students, virtual and asynchronous learning is not the long-term solution to quality education of our children. I believe we need to use the remaining time in this spring semester to transition to more in-person learning for our middle and high school students so we can get comfortable and develop tools, methods, and protocols for safe full-time learning in the fall. We don't, I almost promise that we'll be back here in August discussing options and ideas on less than full-time learning come the fall semester. We are an innovative, inclusive, and inspiring community. We have some of the best staff, resources, teachers, and facilities in the state. We can't continue to move forward safely to bring our kids back to more in-person schooling. Let's not settle for 2 days a week for the remainder of the semester. Every step we take now will be better for it in the fall. Thank you.
The last person speaking in person here is Diana Heisler.
My name is Diana Heisler and I live at 6632 Boulder Lane. I'm a parent of a Middleton High School and middle school student. I'm also an educator who has spent the last year working very hard to teach students online. The students I teach are adults who come from underrepresented and at-risk groups. And I am telling you that it is not going well for my students. I am bracing myself for cohorts of students who will come to me in college having essentially missed a third of high school. I believe it's time to let 5th through 12th grade students return to school full time. COVID is scary. Allowing children to languish isolated in front of screens for so long should scare people too. Closing schools is a tidy approach to mitigation, but its benefits do not outweigh its costs. Unfortunately, we are going to be living with COVID for many years to come. Herd immunity is unlikely with an RNA virus that has a high mutation rate and an immune system response that does not give lifelong immunity. We're also facing vaccine hesitancy. As more students drift away from education, misinformation about herd immunity and vaccines will get a stronger footing. One of the things that scares me the most is the precedent that's been set. The speed at which you close down and the sluggishness in reopening, despite the evidence and expert recommendations, worries me. Things are pretty good now. This is the time to reopen fully with some of the school year left. No, we can't guarantee that opening up will be perfectly safe, and we can't guarantee that this won't all happen again. We need a better approach than shutting kids in their homes. This has been a difficult and frustrating year for children who have no public voice to speak for them. In addition to life and health for some people, one thing that has been lost to the pandemic that can't be replaced is the year of childhood. College students can take a year off and come back. High school is one and done. Childhood passes and is gone. Every single person making these decisions got to receive a middle school and high school education on par with their peers. In addition to the direct consequences of mislearning and extracurricular activities, there are the implications, communities opening bars and movie theaters before allowing children to return to school full time. It's hard enough to promote education in this culture, but continuing to send the message that everything else matters more than school is going to hit us hard on the backswing when we try to reverse course and tell kids, yes, school does matter more than hanging out in blocks. I know there are logistical problems to be solved, but communities all over the country and region are making this work. Middleton is a progressive community of intelligent people. Let's show children that when the stakes are high, we work harder than ever to find solutions that are in their best interests.
I request that you open the schools fully for grades 5 through 12. Let them see that we care about them and that we want to give their lives back on track. Thank you.
We have Amanda Faisler online. You can go ahead, Amanda.
Good evening. My name is Amanda Fassler. I'm a resident of the district at 3102 Springfield Road in Cross Plains and have three children, a son at Glacier Creek and two daughters at MHS. I'm speaking tonight on behalf of both myself and my husband to express our concern that the school board is considering opening the middle schools and high school to a four-day instructional model without cohorts. This is not the time to be fully opening schools for our middle school and high school students. According to DHS tracking, COVID activity in Dane County is still high. In the very short time that this high school has been open, we've received three emails about COVID positive students, with four students currently having tested positive and 33 currently in quarantine for close contact. At the middle schools, there's also been positive cases with others in quarantine. Even with the revised CDC guidelines of 3 feet distance in the classroom and 6 feet for eating, physical education, band, choir, etc., our children cannot appropriately distance themselves if all students are in school. It simply is not possible. For example, if middle school classrooms are set up to accommodate the 3 foot spacing, how will students be spaced 6 feet apart for lunch? Anyone who's been in the middle or high schools during passing time knows that the hallways are packed shoulder to shoulder and keeping an appropriate distance will be impossible. As parents, we agreed to keep our children in the universal model because we trusted the administration and board to keep our children's health at the forefront of all decision making. A decision for kids to go back to school full time is not in line with keeping our students safe. We also want to share that for some children, being back in school is negatively impacting their mental health as much as those children whose mental health was impacted by being isolated at home. While one of our children has anxiety about needing to take his mask off just to eat lunch, our high schooler is eating alone in her car at lunch while her friends gather maskless to eat together. She feels lonely and hurt. We listened to the board meeting earlier in the year where members of the board were upset and extremely verbal that student mental health was being impacted by virtual learning. And there was even a statement made that some students were suicidal. Imagine now being the student who has to eat lunch alone while watching her friends gather together, laughing and having a great time without her. Please do not move the middle and high schoolers to a full 4 day schedule. Next fall, when everyone has had the opportunity to be vaccinated, is the right time. We need to stay the course for now and not let our guard down and not ease up on restrictions. Thank you.
So is there anyone else to talk to? No, that's it for public comments. Okay, and then in terms of the written comments that we had submitted, that came in on the form, we had one that wants to return middle school to extending the in-person learning at the middle school level. At the high school level, we had five that wanted the increased learning time at the high school. We had on the concept of returning both middle and high school, there were nine that said increase the learning time at both facilities. Six said do not do it at both facilities. On the topic of the sustainability resolution, there were three comments that came in support of it. And there were two comments that came in asking for an opportunity to switch models. And I'm sorry, we categorized that based on kind of how their notes were written. So it's, I'm sorry, it's a little confusing, but it gives you an idea of the kind of written comment that we received. In terms of correspondence and board communication, does anyone have anything that you would like to add? I just wanted to comment that we had a listening session tonight with our teachers from Sauk Trail and West Middleton, which was a nice opportunity to hear their experiences. And one of the things that I was very impressed to hear was how beneficial the small groups learning opportunities have been. That was one of the things that was stressed as kind of a silver lining in everything we're dealing with. The other thing that I wanted to mention, I want to acknowledge and thank Superintendent Minogue, who sent out a message of support and inclusivity in the district in light of the loss of Asian Americans in Atlanta, Georgia last week, and asking our community to support our students and staff, our Asian American students and staff. So thank you for doing that. Paul, is there anything on the legislative agenda that you would like to share?
No.
Okay. With that, I will turn it over to Dana for the superintendent's report.
Sure, good evening. We have now fully transitioned to our in-person learning model for students in our universal program. And so far, we are seeing very little incidence of COVID-19 in our schools. Our schools are trying their best to do their part in keeping community spread low so we can continue to keep our schools open and our athletic teams competing. We do have a few positive student cases at Middleton High School, and as a result, several students are in quarantine. We will continue to conduct contact tracing according to Public Health Madison Dane County guidelines so that we can keep everyone as safe as possible. A reminder to families that there are no appeals involved in our contact tracing process. If you are contacted by our nursing staff because your student is in close contact, we ask that you respect those decisions and keep your student home to monitor symptoms. Last week, I visited several elementary classrooms and observed our teachers using both in-person and concurrent teaching strategies. The planning and preparation that is being done to make sure students who are coming into our schools and those who are joining their classrooms virtually are engaged and learning is really impressive. And I want to thank our educators for everything they are doing to make a blended model work for kids. Lastly, I want to congratulate Dr. Rainey Briggs, who has accepted the position of superintendent in the Baraboo School District. The board will be approving his resignation from our district this evening, and we want to thank him for everything he has done over the past 5 years in his role as Director of Elementary Education. We wish him all the best as he transitions to his new position. Report.
All right. Moving on in our agenda, under our consent agenda is the environmental resolution. And I would like to, before I list the items in the consent agenda, I did want to thank and acknowledge those from our community. We had a lot of really nice supportive messages of that resolution. Our district has had longstanding programs aimed at energy conservation, which has saved the district a lot of money. And we're very proud of the student involvement that went into the preparing of that resolution with the assistance of Daphne Wu and Amalia Warner. So I just wanted to mention that. Under consent agenda, I would like to offer up approval of bills payable, approval of resignations, approval of staff appointments, and approval of the sustainability resolution. Can I get a motion?
A motion for approval, Sean Highland.
And a second?
I'll second, Ms. Green.
Okay, and I will do a voice vote. Ann Bauer?
Yes.
Sean Highland?
Aye.
Bob Green?
Aye.
Linda Green?
Aye.
Katie Morgan?
Aye.
Pat Smith?
Aye.
Bob Hesselbein?
Aye.
Paul Keating?
Aye.
And I am aye as well. With that, we will go back to Sherry is sitting in the next speaker to Sherry for the 4 days a week of in-person learning for elementary students in the universal model.
Yeah, thank you. So in the board packet, there is a summary of what you approved at the last meeting, and then just a few updates as we continue to move forward with our planning. Included in the packet is an update on timeline and communication to families that will be going out between now and the April 19th implementation of students coming into the building 4 days a week. There's also information about distancing, which we also were informed last week that Public Health Madison James Pony will also be updating their order to reflect the updates from the CDC and the guidance that they are giving to allow for 3-foot distancing. And our hope that once we bring all of the students back, we will not be able to maintain 6-foot distancing at all times. And then in terms of meals, we will be employing a variety of strategies to address distancing during meal times. And in part, that's for a number of reasons. Our class sizes vary from school to school and from grade to grade within schools. And then also the classroom sizes and layouts vary from school to school and from classroom to classroom within grade in those schools. And so each school and principal and their staff are working through those plans to determine what is the best approach for lunch seating or arrangement by school and by grade. When possible, we will continue to have students eat lunch in their classrooms. And our priorities in terms of maintaining mitigation are physical distancing first, continuing to use strategies that encourage students to eat quietly, to face in the same direction, and then to emphasize hand hygiene. In cases where we have larger classes, because they range from 14 to 24, we may have a class that is split across 2 spaces, or we may have some classes that utilize space in the cafeteria. So that will really depend on the particular size of a class or the classroom space itself. Encore, we will start using Encore classrooms that begins this week, but we will continue with the rotation that we've been using up until now as well. So where students and classes are not rotating as frequently as they used to. So we do day 1 for a week, then we do day 2 for a week, so that we reduce the number of environments that classes are moving to each week. The transportation form went out to families last week so that all families have the opportunity if they need to change the choice that they made in terms of transportation. Now that we're in a 4-day model, they can do that. And then we'll just continue to work with the elementary principal and coach team on a weekly basis as we continue to work through more details, mitigation plans, and the more frequent updates that we've been getting from Public Health Madison-Dade County. The summary.
Any questions for Sherry? I have a question. When is the transportation form due back?
It went out last week and it is due back Wednesday night.
I just asked if there was a big change in.
I have not looked at the data yet. Perry sends out reminders about every other day.
Actually, every day. We use social media, we use the mobile app, tomorrow, home, all of them. So I think when I looked this afternoon, we had 1,200, 1,300 responses. So, I mean, we're not there yet, but I mean, that's a pretty good response rate at this point. And again, some families, even though we told everyone we wanted them to fill it out, there will be families who aren't going to fill it out, assuming that they're going to keep the same transportation that they had to this point. But we will follow up.
I was just wondering if there's been any feedback from teachers or other staff members about the return to 4 days a week. Any concerns or any other feedback like that from parents?
I mean, I think there isn't anything we don't receive feedback on, in particular this year, right? And I would say any particular decision, right? There is a spectrum of opinions.
Any strong opinions is what you're
asking. I mean, I think we've had mixed feedback. I think there are certainly staff who feel very good about having the students back more days. And I think there are concerns about having more students back. I think there were staff, and at the younger grades in particular, we heard some trends in feedback about once students were coming back 2 days a week, that the days students were at home the engagement was harder, and that the concurrent model was harder on the youngest students. And I think when we're in the classrooms, we can certainly see our teachers are amazing. They really are amazing. And I think they're making the best of a very challenging situation. And it's still hard work in whatever model we're using, right? Because they're employing the mitigation strategies and delivering instruction. And so I think I would say a lot of positive feedback and yes, concerns as well. I mean, Dana or Lori, because you're both at all of those listening sessions, or Barb, I think if there's something you feel like.
I could hear things on both sides of the spectrum, just like we did during the information that we heard tonight publicly. So there's no one opinion that seems to override any other one.
And that's, I want to know, did you guys think about whenever the weather is better, eating lunch outside? Yeah,
that's actually on our list with when I met with the elementary principals. It's just not something you can depend on regularly enough that it's actually like on our published list.
Mm-hmm.
But that's certainly another option, that when weather permits, classes could go outside. The logistics on that are more complicated when we're talking about entire schools, but that's certainly a possibility. I mean, at really anything outside. And I certainly do think even when elementary was first back, we saw some teachers trying to do things outside when they could, just to give students the opportunity to get out when they can.
Any other questions for Terry? Thank you, Terry.
Mm-hmm.
And moving on in our agenda is the discussion of increased in-person learning in grades 5 through 12.
Great. I'd like to ask our secondary administrators to join us at the table, please. And Sherry and Lori, you can go to the back table. I'll come to you. Principal at Middleton High School, Bill Burton, Principal of Park Street Community School, Sam Ricks, Principal at Primary Middle School, and Ken Nuts, Principal of Glacier Creek Middle School. We appreciate your presence here tonight. Tonight, our secondary team is going to provide more detailed information about the realities involved in increasing in-person learning in our middle and high school. Before we begin, I want to let the board and the community know that I have absolute faith and confidence in our building leaders here this evening, and know that whatever is decided tonight, they will execute that plan with a very high level of competence. We know there are many benefits related to increasing in-person learning for our students at the middle and high school level. This would mean more in-person access to teachers and to peers, more structure and routine throughout the week, and better mental health outcomes for some of our kids. Through the discussion this evening, we want to communicate not only the benefits associated with an increase to in-person learning at the secondary level, but also the realities, so that the board and the community have a good understanding of what a 4-day-a-week model will entail. Go back one minute. Did you skip one, Cheryl? Throughout the pandemic, we have needed to weigh medical guidance and advice and operational realities. I'm sorry, sure. Do you have the most updated presentation? Okay, I will. Just one second, please. No, that's okay. Go ahead, keep it there. That's fine.
Okay.
Yep, that's fine. Perfect. We said it before, it means true now. The pandemic has impacted all of us in every way. And at the secondary level, all aspects of operation have been adjusted throughout the year. We have supported two separate instructional models for our students and our staff, and our approach is different than approaches in surrounding school districts, which makes comparisons among us a bit challenging. We have shifted staff between our models to maximize efficiency, and we thank those educators who have needed to make a change in assignment this year. You have all handled those transitions beautifully. When we transitioned to in-person learning at the middle school level in particular, schedules were adjusted to lower the number of transitions during the school day, something we were encouraged to consider from our medical and public health partners. Throughout the pandemic, we have needed to weigh medical guidance and advice and operational realities. Because the medical and public health information and guidance has evolved with emerging science and evidence related to COVID-19 in schools, incorporating constantly updated guidance into district and building protocols and operations has been difficult. Just last week, the Center for Disease Control changed their guidance to schools in the area of physical distancing from 6 feet to 3 feet, which will definitely help our educators and students and families feel more assured about our distancing restrictions in some of our learning environments. Our recent transitions to in-person learning in our middle and high schools have gone very well. Our staff, students, and families are letting us know they feel assured by our mitigation protocols. We are seeing very little virus incidents in our schools, and we are looking forward to our elementary students in the universal model coming into our schools 4 days a week beginning on April 19th. We want to reiterate that we do have every intention of being open full time for all students in all grade levels next school year. We still may need some mitigation protocols in place, but we are planning for our students to be in our schools 5 days each week. We're excited to know that many, if not all, of our high school students will be vaccinated by the fall semester, and also many more of our community members will be vaccinated as well. Our principals are going to provide some level of detail and insight on several factors involved in our decision-making. I know our principals want to see students in their schools as much as possible, as quickly as possible. I also know that in our largest buildings, there are challenges that are unique. At Glacier Creek, we have 780 students in our universal model. At Cromery, there are nearly 1,000 students in our universal model. And at MHS, there are approximately 2,000 students in our universal model. Many of the considerations that will be highlighted this evening apply to both the middle and high school levels. And of course, the construction factor is only applicable at MHS.
All right, I'm gonna start it from the secondary team on this slide. I'm gonna talk about some information that's really general for both levels that's represented in the secondary. But before I do that, I just want to say thank you for the opportunity to talk about this and to explain the details that we've been noticing as we go through the planning process. We definitely don't envy your job. I don't think anybody envies any leadership, and I know that goes both ways during this time. We really do see our role today providing as much information as possible so you can make the most informed decision. And I want to be clear from our standpoint, any decision that's made, knowing all pieces to the puzzle in our minds, is a good decision. And that's something that we plan on supporting. So we're just hopeful that the information that we're able to provide is something that will give us a very healthy conversation about the reality of increased time, which we all acknowledge would be a net benefit. You'll notice on this slide, we do have some images of classrooms, what they currently look like and what they would look like. At the secondary level, you will notice that all of our tables are approximately 5 feet in length. Because they're 5 feet in length, we use about 1 foot of space in between tables to make sure that all students who are currently participating in our universal model are 6 feet apart at all times. It's really encouraging that the CDC has updated their guidance, and now 3 feet is something that we can look to as routine and just something that's a benefit to us. But really from our planning standpoint, if you look at the operations, the length of our desk, how many chairs we have at the secondary level, it's really no reprieve to us. So if we were to transition to the building 100% with all of our students, we would not be going from 6 feet to 3 feet. In most cases, we'll be going from 6 feet to less than 1 foot. At each table that's approximately 5 feet in length, we would have to have two students to a table, then another student in front of them and behind them. We're looking at approximately 4 to 6 close contacts per student if we were to increase all of our students into the building at current spacing and current operations of materials. What that means from a logistical standpoint is right now with our COVID mitigation protocols, we can reasonably guarantee, as long as practice is followed, if one student gets a positive, there doesn't need to be any quarantining of other students. But to move to 100% in a classroom that averaged in the mid to upper 20s and outliers at 34 and 35 in some cases, the situation we would rise into would be, on average, a positive case could get us up to 40 close contacts at the middle level. I will pass it over to the high school for some high school specifics.
Before you do that, I have a question. As you talk about the fact that we're going to have a much shorter distance than the recommended 6 or even down to 3, I have to ask a question. Other school districts, not only inside Dade County, but outside Dade County, have been dealing with this particular situation for a very long period of time with less than 3 feet. I'm not going to say that, but I'm just making the assumption based on the fact that their classroom sizes are similar. Do you have any information about how much spread is going on, how many schools are being closed down? Because based on what you're saying, with that close to that, you could not isolate, you would have to isolate an entire classroom. Do we have any information based on that fact that there are a large number of schools that have isolated classrooms based on that situation?
Based on our current guidance, as far as what we consider a close contact within our own policies and recommendations from Public Health Madison Dane County, if a student is within 6 feet, which is soon to be updated to 3.
Well, I understand. What I'm just curious about is other school districts are in a similar situation, whether you have that information or other people in the administration have it. Many schools have been in session for the entire school year with closer contact than 6 feet. Do we have some type of an idea of how many schools have actually shut down because of the fact of the cohorts?
I can respond to that, Bob.
Because thank you.
The course of the pandemic, there is no statewide database that gives us that information. So it's all through news reports or through connecting to other school systems. And there have been ebbs and flows of districts who've had to close schools, districts who've had to close individual classrooms. That was much more prevalent in October and November of this year. And I think that as protocols have been perfected, we haven't seen as many schools or classrooms needed to be closed down, but there are several school systems that also post their data like we do on our webpage. And there are a few that we monitor, mostly on the other side of the state because they have been in person since the beginning of the school year. And they continue to see the need to quarantine students, but we haven't heard as many classroom or school closures. But the quarantining protocols continue.
So where I'm going with this, so a natural result of a change from current policy to increased learning in 4-day would be an increase in quarantines as a potential because of the fact that we would have this.
Sure, it's a potential. It's a crystal ball kind of a thing because we don't know how many positive cases we will have in our setting. If and when we do have a positive case, there will be more contact tracing and more students who would need to quarantine because of that singular positive case.
Right. But the natural outcome would be that we would be going to the next steps that other school districts have been going through for a longer period of time.
Sure, which might mean a classroom quarantine, which might mean a school closure. Correct.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. One thing I'd like to mention, Mr. Green, is that the two schools that I've spoken directly with, which is Hudson, my former district, as well as Oconomowoc High School, both of those school districts have ebbed and flowed all year where they've gone fully virtual,
they've opened hybrid, then they've gone back fully virtual, then they've gone hybrid, then they all come back. And so the couple of schools that I've been in contact with, that's kind of been the model that they've had.
And I'm going to apologize, you know, on this type of questioning, but the natural, this is a natural question that's going to come up. Mm-hmm. But yet when I ask the question, I get a vague answer. I don't get a real specific answer. So it's disconcerting to me that it's not an answer that should be readily available. I understand it's not. But there are a large number of schools that have done this. It just makes it difficult for me to make a good decision without the information. So that's where my concerns are at, because the community is calling for this.
So I also was going to talk about some specific spaces at the high school. Currently, we've got our music courses are in areas that are not designed for their classes because of construction. If we brought all of our students back, obviously, again, they would have to be seated 1 to 2 feet. 44 choral students would be in one classroom. 55 students would be in the black box, which is also used as a storage area during this construction phase. Also, our science, tech ed, and CTE students would need to rotate through the active learning labs, with some students sitting and waiting for others to do the lab. Currently, in the hybrid model, an entire class is able to distance while doing the hands-on labs. Most of our FIED classes would have close to 60 students with one third less of the space. We're using the gym, the varsity gym for lunch and a hallway. And so that limits, again, the space that our FIED teachers. The other implication would be it's more instructional time for all of the cleaning that would increase because of the volume.
And the last piece I would add for the middle level is, due to the large class sizes in some select courses, we would need to run a separate section of the class that would essentially be separated with another adult who would be supervising. So some classes will have to continue synchronously within the building. We've identified between the two middle schools 6 to 8 at each one of our buildings that would necessarily need to go into this. We also have several other classes that are kind of on the outlier, close to 35 students, that pending the number of spacing we're able to secure, as really exploring our options, we might have to increase that number slightly.
Do those tend to be older grades or younger grades at the middle school level that would be in that situation?
For me, it's mostly 6 through 8. Same. We have a different plan for fifth graders, so it's kind of all over. It's primarily our world language classes, which we always have a lot of students that participate in world language, and spread through a traditional schedule will kind of cover all that with the less transitions. It just puts more pressure on how many sections you have.
Yes, this is Peg. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I'm double masked here and I'm half muzzled. My wife is
going to hear you.
I'd like some information about the school construction going on now. And I don't need a tight number, but how much floor space do you have now that you can't use because of the construction, as opposed to if there had been no construction going on? Because you're really pressing down the space you have.
Do you want me to go into the construction piece? I did have a separate slide on that.
Yeah, always.
Is that okay? Okay, great.
And Sean, do you
want to
ask the question?
Yes. So we're shifting going to be a shift in the guidance from 6 feet down to 3 feet. It's my understanding, I've shared some information with the administration in the past, that the amount of particulate shedding that people experience or give off is based upon their physical activity. So if you're just sitting talking, the amount of particulate that you're shedding is minimal. If you're talking in a small whisper, that increases up. And if you're in physical activity, the amount that you're giving off is quite large. So the distance between individuals is really based upon the amount of particulates that they're shedding and the likelihood of that if they have the viral load, that being shedded to somebody else, and also based upon the masking. Based upon the guidance that what we're seeing here, and the amount of physical activity that we're going to be experiencing, or the students are going to be experiencing in the classroom, do we have any kind of sense as to what kind of increase in risk there may be from going from that 6 foot down to 3 foot, or even a foot of distance between the students?
Well, the masking protocols will remain. And from everything we're hearing, our students have been really largely very good about adhering to that, as have our educators. Within the context of the classroom, outside of discussing and talking, I'm not sure how much more activity there would be that would add to what Sean was concerned about. I'm not sure if there's any other perspective you could add to that.
Only thing I can think of is maybe during like science labs and things like that, where our teachers are getting creative to be able to still know with the number of students in the classroom. And so some students may be sitting at the desk and working, and others up at the lab. It's that kind of movement. But I don't think there's going to be like strenuous activity per se in a classroom where they're sitting next to each other. In a FIED space where we can spread out a little bit more, we're doing a little bit more activity in the country.
I would say with that consideration, we can work with our world language teachers to try to curb that a little bit. A large part of world language acquisition is repetition. So it's kind of a double-edged sword there, but that is something that can be shared with the team for planning purposes.
And I also want to mention for physical education, weather dependent, obviously we would use the outdoors. So
I think it's, that is a perfect struggle of is getting kids back in school and then asking them to sit quietly next to each other. It's a very real tension in the classroom. Like, teachers want the opportunity for kids to be engaging and talking, and that increases the risk, especially when they're right next to each other. So one of the other things that is recommended from a virus mitigation perspective is cohorting. We want to make sure you understand that at the middle and high school level, cohorting is not possible given the schedule. So the combination of cohorting and the close distance means that we will have significantly higher need for contact tracing if we have any positive cases. Contact tracing is already very challenging, and we would expect that this would definitely increase the amount that we would need to be doing. Lunch and recess is obviously one of those spaces. We have systems in place to monitor and keep track of when students are, who students are with, but that is certainly also a challenge. Dana mentioned the mask. I think all of us would report that we have had very little problems with students. Students are wearing the masks, they're wearing them correctly, they're taking any redirection that they're given. That has not been a problem. And we'll continue to emphasize that and hand washing, which does seem to be the biggest key to the virus transmission.
And students are continuing for us to sanitize entering their room and exiting. So lots of sanitation.
Before you go further, you indicated that students are doing the sanitation, it's not the teachers. Is that correct? I just want to make sure I understood that.
Yep.
With the supervision of the teacher.
Yeah,
understood. That's different than what I've heard before.
And then checking that it's all through that. Yeah.
Thank you.
More specifically around lunches, which we see as an admin team as our prior greatest risk for at time of risk for kids. Probably one of our highest concerns as far as just safety for all of our students and our staff. Obviously, you got to remove your mask at that time. We're looking at different options and creative ways to look at that. I think, for the middle level, we're going to be cycling grade levels through half at a time. So we'll be cycling 8 kind of lunch sessions within a day, which is going to be pretty intense and some quick turnaround for us. So we'll be looking at doing that. Mitigation strategy that we're using is we're going to try to utilize the outside weather permitting as much as possible. We've even talked about whether we could rent wedding tents and tables and all that kind of stuff, right? So those are things that we'll look into and I've already started to. Knowing that for KMS, it's a little bit more of a challenge. They still have the green space that we do out at Glacier. So they may have to utilize a parking lot or something if they were to do something of that nature. We've both talked about using our bleachers, per se, and having kids, you know, sit up on the bleachers and kind of sit sideways and eat on the bleachers as a way to create more space within our gymnasiums and cafeteria areas. But we'll have to use two large areas to be able to feed our students because we have overlapping lunches. We spend just over half of our day feeding kids. It's pretty major. I always tell families and parents, in a regular school year, we feed about 180,000 kids a year, right? Through the lunches every day. That's a lot. Most restaurants are doing that kind of stuff. So it's an operation. I think that was all I had.
Yeah. So I did a little bit of data tracking in these 7 days that we've been in school. First of all, we have 437 seats currently for lunch. And you saw those spaces when you were on the tour. It was in the concourse, in the cafeteria, and in the varsity gym where we had the bleachers pulled out. So that's 437 seats. So in the last 7 days, we looked at our lunch tracker that we asked students to fill out. And we had about 60% of our students leave the building during lunch. When it was bad weather, which was last Monday, it snowed. We had 53% of students left for lunch. And our seating capacity was stretched to the max. Every space was taken, and we had to have a couple of kids kind of sitting on the floor in front. So obviously, lunch would pose some significant challenges at MHS. The lunch tracker is helpful. Students forget. I mean, it's definitely not 100%. I guess we've had some kids eat lunch in France and other places that they haven't actually told us where they were eating lunch. So again, supervision is an issue. We have every staff member who's not teaching or serving students is supervising the lunch spaces. We also check the PAC, but we actually have three classes in the PAC during that time. So that isn't an option either.
I think this is true for them as well. By current projections, we believe that during lunch, kids will sit within 3 feet of each other to be able to see everybody. Right?
And consistently around three.
There's going to be somewhere around 3 to inside 3 feet. So.
I have a question.
Yep.
Right now, if I remember right, you need the students meet in the classroom.
Yep.
That will not be the case.
No, because right now, if we have 25 to 30 some kids, they'll be within, you know, almost touching shoulders as they're eating.
They would be closer in the classroom than in what you're proposing.
Okay. So we're bringing them to our cafeteria and gymnasium spaces to create more space.
And if I remember right, your tables in the cafeteria are also round. So
yes,
would be facing each other.
Some of them are half. Some of them are round. Some of them are like long bench stuff.
So would you have like half the kids eating in the classroom and the other half of the class eating in the cafeteria?
No, we don't have enough supervision to be able to do that. Just not enough adult bodies. So we would have half the kids would be outside it, like having a recess. With the classrooms, you got to section them off. So many, you got to have a body for every classroom that we could put them out. So half of them would be at recess for a grade level. The other half would be eating, and then they would basically do it.
The added transitions would require us to either potentially just be okay with less time for recess and eating, or we would have to shorten up some of our classes to make more time for the transitions.
Paul? I apologize, this question's out of order. I should have asked it earlier.
I've got a middle school kid and a high school kid, and their phones are practically like a vital organ on the outside of their bodies. How do contact tracing apps work? Is that, honest to God, don't know. Is that something that could be
used? We don't utilize them at the middle level because we just don't have enough kids that even have phones.
Okay.
So it's really not a thing for us. We'll be using assigned seating and things like
that. Are there enough kids who do have phones that if, even though it wouldn't be a, I mean, obviously they have to change the world to let them carry it with them if I understand how they work correctly, but is that something that would at least help with contact tracing?
I can kind of speak to that.
Good, thank you.
Yeah, Danielle, Preventive Health Services. So, quite honestly, we would rather rely on teachers and the sources of who's there or not. So, I, you know, same thing with kids are in Paris for lunch. I don't know where they might or might not be on the contact tracing app. Like, it might be helpful, but honestly, it would might add a new complex layer. We need to figure out that piece while also going through 20 other people already. So, even if there was an app, we would have to call, confirm, figure that part out too. So it still would be a part of a speaking process. So I think it might add another piece that actually makes it more difficult for us.
Okay, thank you.
I remember reading somewhere, my apologies on this, that if we went to a 4-day week for the high school, that there would be a possibility that it would not be enough parking for the students, is that
yes,
correct?
Yes, and I'll cover that in the construction piece.
Okay, I'll wait till you get that point. Yeah. Thank you.
You got it. So one thing we did want to make clear, if we were to move to a full 4-day in person, we would need to continue concurrent. We have talked about different ways in which we can help to minimize that, potentially setting that to certain times of day for kids who are at home. We do see, we don't see it as being a situation where it might be 2 to 3 kids who are now streaming, so it's less of a need. In all actuality, between close contacts, between kids who might test positive, as well as planned absences, because even kids who are choosing to quarantine after spring break or have family situations that come up, we do anticipate that being an important need to continue. Right now with the middle level, we are advising teachers to do a minimum of about 20 minutes of streaming. We would change our guidance to up to 100% of the class to make sure that kids who are unable to attend or are choosing out of their own safety are able to fully participate in the lesson when they are not there. Also, because we know we won't be able to facilitate model changes moving forward, this is the route that we go. So we want to make sure that every student has access. And we want to be smart about how we do that, so we're not doing it every single minute of the day. I already mentioned a little bit about the need for us to have potentially 2 adults in 2 locations for 1 class. That is currently impacting some of our core classes, and this will move to impact our encore classes as well. But one thing we wanted to also voice was that our ensemble music, our band and orchestra, it takes place on our asynchronous days when kids are at home. There's no room in the schedule to insert it, and finding time to do it inside the day would require a pull-out model where kids are missing either 4 or encore classes, only further complicating contact tracing. And the teachers who will be doing that, they would not be free to supervise students, so it would inadvertently also increase class sizes. So our orchestra and band classes would need to continue mostly on a limited basis on Wednesdays and where the teachers are able to fit those students in.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Has that been explained at all to parents?
No, because no decision has been made yet.
Okay. I wondered about, it sounded like there was an issue right now, and because we've been getting messages, and so I was curious if how it's being handled, if what you're proposing is different than how it's being handled now, and just where that was going. Okay.
Yeah, it's been a relative, I'm sorry.
No, go ahead.
It's been a relatively new development. I believe I started getting looked at on communications around the same time as you. And I know that is the case because I talked to one of my teachers and I found out that one of our earlier conversations about our model back when we moved to hybrid, he was curious about what that might mean with an increase. And I told him, well, with our current schedule, there wouldn't be a space, but that's something we would need to explore. Part of the options that we did put before you today, we also talked about a potential half-day model at the middle level. If we were to do a half-day model, that would allow us to have encores asynchronously in the afternoon. So it wouldn't eliminate opportunities for issues like that. It also would eliminate the need for us to have two adults in two locations for 6 to 8 courses for sure, potentially more.
Yes, I do. Regarding that, if we were to increase 4 full days for middle schoolers, would this impact the music orchestra for virtual students as well?
Yes, it will. Right now, there are lessons that take place on Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday. Those won't be able to happen anymore.
At all.
It would be up to the teacher's own flexibility to make that happen during their own planning period. Or it would have to happen during advisory, just because there would be no kids. Their availability would be significantly limited. They might be able to pull it off, and I can't speak to those teachers fully, because also we haven't fleshed out what all of the options are, but there will be decreased availability for sure.
And if we were to do half the model at the middle level, then would it impact the virtual or not?
It wouldn't impact the virtual or the universal. Okay. So if we were to do half day, there would be opportunities for both. Mm-hmm. Moving to a full day, it would completely eliminate it for universal.
Okay.
And it would reduce it for fully virtual, the size of the Wednesdays for both students.
Okay. Thank you.
You have all heard enough to know that the impact on students is going to be all over the board. We absolutely have students who would be excited to be back in school more, would take as much time in school as they could get. We also do absolutely have students who are likely to be very concerned about attending if all of the students are there. And you heard from families in both cases, so I think you have the picture of that. The one thing we know is a struggle for everyone are multiple transitions. And we've had a lot of transitions already this year. And we do know from schools that have been through this that the coming in and out related to quarantining is something we should be expecting. If we have students that are close and we're not able to do some of the physical distancing and contact tracing when they're coming into contact with so many students.
All right. So in, I would say that, again, the 7 days that teachers have been at school, we're in the process, obviously, of developing routines. Necessary to include our at-home students who are logging on for a portion of that. I would say we have some staff that are feeling ready to bring students back into the building, but many staff are concerned about the possibility, mainly with the distancing. Problems posed include the fact that not all staff are vaccinated, and obviously that students are not yet vaccinated. There's additional stress and anxiety placed on both students and staff. We already are pulling every day a significant number of staff for prep periods to cover teachers that are out of the building for either medical accommodations or because they're ill or a variety of reasons. We probably have up to, I would say 10 to 15 classrooms that we're covering every day with other staff members taken out of their prep time to be able to cover the classes. So we know that that takes a toll on teachers. We hear from staff that are experiencing pivot fatigue. That's my word. Not only for saying the word pivot, but really pivot fatigue with really all of the shifts in instructional models. And this could have a negative effect on morale and an increase in stress levels. I don't know if you wanted to add anything regarding your staff.
We hear, the board hears every now and then about the sub situation. Mm-hmm. But obviously, I know was something I brought up as a concern at the beginning of the year, that we actually go out and hire some teachers for permanent subs, anticipating that this would be an issue, indicated that the budget wasn't in the budget at the time. So talk to me a little bit about the sub finder, how we're working with subs and finding subs, obviously competing with everybody else. But this sounds like a very large problem that's not only going to occur now, but it's going to occur next year. That if we're talking about putting the stress on staff, you're pulling them out of plan, and then you're pulling them to do something that they weren't planning on doing. We didn't plan a lot, so my apologies for that. But obviously that's going to increase the stress levels on that. Is there some type of a solution to this?
Yeah. So we have been very diligent in trying to hire permanent substitutes as district employees and then assigning them to areas. I will tell you that the pool of just finding people who are willing to come in as substitutes has significantly dwindled. Not even just as a short term coming in for the day, but also somebody who's willing to be even long term. Part of it is one, everybody is, you know, just this whole, the whole COVID experience, not having vaccinations has impacted people's willingness to come in. But it also is at a time period when it's really tough to be a substitute because you're coming in not being familiar with the curriculum. You're there on a short-term basis, and then you're also trying to learn the technology that it takes to not only do the technology with the students who are in front of you, but also trying to handle the technology with the students who are zooming in. So there's just a lot of factors right now that are impacting our ability to attract substitutes. We've been working with POC, the company that we normally work with, to develop a stronger connection of substitutes who are willing to come in. But there, I mean, all over, there people are experiencing a real decline in the number of people who are willing to come in and assist in those areas. We've also had conversations about trying to find people who can come in and just do classroom monitoring. Like they don't do anything but sit in the room. And some of that is easy to find, but we run into the same issue of if that we aren't necessarily the place right now where people want to go and work.
Certainly sounds like an agenda item for a future date.
Mm-hmm. Great. I'll touch on the next piece. This one is really similar to what's been stated by the board and our senior leadership time and time again. The feedback, it really is decidedly mixed. And as we think about our operational standpack and potential impact on families, we think it's really clear that those students who would benefit from increased time will have those benefits. And those students who have anxiety, they will struggle with that, but eventually we know they will overcome it. As we look at our own operations and we try to figure out what is the impact of increased learning, one thing we can say for sure is because stepping away from social distancing, there will be more close contacts on each potential case. So that's the real operational piece we wanted to highlight with this slide.
All right, and then this slide. Oh, sorry about that,
Ann. I had asked this, but Donna, you're a panelist, and you asked me. I didn't get a chance to kind of do. In looking at the half day model, I was interested if we had reached out to all of our partners, for example, the youth center, mm-hmm. because that would really have a huge implication on how they operate.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a lot of families that rely on the youth center for after school. So, I mean, I think that there's other things that can come up
mm-hmm.
with the model change. I didn't know if any conversations have happened with Gabriella or...
That's a really good question, and I actually touched base with Eric not too long before this meeting. He's been in really close contact with Gabrielle to talk about that over the year. And one thing he wanted me to know ahead of this meeting is that they have been extremely flexible, and they've modeled a lot of their programming for serving our students. So since we've actually been able to move to the hybrid model, for some students, we've been able to provide direct transportation there. So one thing we do know, pending their own capacity limits, how they approach social distancing and their own occupancy, we would be able to provide potential direct transit over there or potentially house them here in Bromberg. But those are conversations we would need to have once we start moving in a certain direction. But I will say that flexibility exists, and we have a very strong partnership when it comes to the marriage of our programming.
Great.
I have another question for Peg about, and Jill probably on this one. A half day model would mean that students are really only at the high school level there for a couple of blocks, and then they leave and take lunch elsewhere, and then do asynchronous for the remainder of the day. But then kids who participate in any of the other activities would then need to find transportation every day back to the campus and then to get picked up again after that to be brought home. So, I mean, I think that there's a lot of additional barriers to participating in a lot of things if we changed to that type of model. And to me, it seems like then you have twice as many people for almost the same in-person time. And then we're also putting this big transportation issue into the mix as well at the same time. Is there any magical solutions that you have considered, I guess?
You're absolutely right. There are a lot of barriers to that model. Some of the barriers that exist are the way MHS would run their schedule. Each class would be about 40 minutes. We're on a block schedule and an A and B schedule. Each class would be about 40 minutes. And then we would not be able to do advisory during that time. We would need to allow probably up to an hour for students to get home and then have lunch. And then resume like asynchronous advisory, ASR, but the shift from 87 minute classes to 40 minutes when we're in advanced placement time and all of those sorts of issues would be a barrier.
As well as with the other forward testing and things that take
place.
Thank you.
One question that I had that came up in a couple of emails that I wanted some clarification on, it was about somebody had said that AP classes are not available to people in the fully virtual option. I wondered if someone could shed some light on that.
AP classes are definitely available. They're for a small number of high-level classes, mostly not AP, but other high-level unique classes that Milton High School offers that wasn't an equivalent. And Peg has opened up all those classes are open to kids. So there are kids who are on their own kind of hybrid schedules that they're coming into Middleton High School for those classes when there was not an equivalent class. Some of them are zooming in every day if they're really not comfortable. They're zooming into the class every day as opposed to zooming in every other day. But in the end, there were no need to say you can't take any classes. There were substitutes that we came up with as options.
My question, I believe, is for Lori or Dana. We are not talking about transportation if we were to choose the half day model for both middle and high.
So we talked to our transportation department before even entertaining this as a concept to make sure that all the routes could be accomplished. The most challenging scenario would be if we opted for a half day option at both middle school and high school, because then there are just some additional routes that would have to be added to that time of day. But we checked with our transportation department and we can make it work with all of the other elementary routes, the 4K routes, etc.
Yeah, I found another problem. regarding special ed minutes, it would kind of require everyone to revisit all the IEPs and service times, which has already had to be done, even if your kid has not changed the models. Like my kids are fully virtual, but when we went back to the hybrid, his times all changed. So I mean, it hasn't been a stable year for any kids in special ed with the minutes. So
that's an excellent point.
They would all have to be redone.
Yes.
Excellent.
One last transportation question, just so there's no doubt anyone's fine in the room or watching from elsewhere. If we take the approach of keeping the high school model the way it is, and we go to the 4-day with middle schools, that has also been looked at in transportation already.
Say that one more time, Bob.
I heard it.
Oh, you heard it? Okay.
Yeah. So the question was, if middle school, say, were to go to half day and high school would stay on the schedule that they're on, can we do it? I would tell you we could do it, but we would need to, I would want people to be informed that that is, that's more routes than we would normally offer, right? So, because we would, we wouldn't be lumping together our middle and our high school anymore, and we would be separating it. So we would, definitely, not to say that it isn't the reason to do it, but there would definitely be a budget impact. And then I'm just, what I'm thinking about are the number of drivers that would then be doing, if you think across the day, they would be doing an elementary route, a middle high school route, a 4K bring them in, a 4K take them home, a middle school route, an elementary route, and then a high school route. That it, they essentially would be driving all day long in order to accommodate like middle on it, one, like one level being at half day and one level being full day. It can be done because we talked to them about fitting it into the schedule. But I wouldn't want anybody to not know that that would be what the impact is, and that we would see an increase in our expenses because it's a route more than we normally would do.
But it's not a good people.
It can be done.
Yeah. And Lori, I have another follow-up question to that. And is, do we have enough drivers to be able to do that?
I would expect that if we add a middle midday run for middle and high, or one of them, that we will have to rely on some of our drive, our office staff to be driving, because there are some people that are hired where they can only do morning, or they can only do night, or they can only do the bookends because they work a different job during the day. So I would expect we would have some office staff that would be driving that, that midday in order to take that, the middle level or high school level home.
Yeah, would there be substantially longer bus rides then as well?
I don't know that they would be longer rides. Okay. They probably would be the same with just fewer kids on them.
Okay. I have another question about the high school schedule. Sorry, I have my questions. The blocks will be about half of the normal block time. But so how many blocks would they get through in a half day?
Four. Okay. They would just be shorter. So it'd be the same number of blocks.
Time would be about equivalent to the hybrid model in minutes per block class.
Yep.
But there would just be twice as many students.
Right.
In each of the
classes. Right. Right.
All right, the slide that I want to share now, just basically we just wanted to share this as some implication for what our recommendation might be later for start times and that. So just wanted to make sure that you were aware of this. So board exam season has come upon us. So one of the things that as we planned our board exam and into the window that we had to deal with, which was an extended window this year, we plan for the kind of the time after spring break when we're asking families to quarantine from travel. And we do have families that are reaching out to us and reaching out to the teachers and letting us know that they plan to quarantine after travel. I think we're also aware that there are families that are traveling that are not going to quarantine, but we are aware of families that do plan to quarantine after traveling over spring break. So what we did was we started our testing kind of from that launch point. And then the way that we had planned our testing out, which was planned out, about a month prior to this conversation. And so our current model meets a lot of our small setting requirements for many students that need to test. And so we set our plan up based on that setting. So So then we have our tests happening on the week of April 19th and the week of April 26th. To make any changes to our number of days in our model and when kids are present and what size those groups are in would require that we kind of rework our testing plan. We also need to keep a fairly big chunk of time on the back end of that, knowing that we're going to have kids during that period of time that are quarantined. Just because that's happened as we've moved through the last month as a hybrid. So any kid that's quarantined, if they're quarantined for 7 days or more, we need to make sure we have hopefully have enough time to get every kid through the first round of testing, and then we have the time within that window to do our makeups and make sure every kid has the opportunity. So it actually gives us kind of a small window in the middle to really get most of our kids done and make sure that we have that time.
Right, I'm just going to summarize what our principals have shared thus far. And there's certainly evidence in our county and across the state that secondary students can safely attend school in the absence of physical distance. We recognize the benefits of coming to school more often that many students will experience. We also know that not every student will view this transition to more in-person learning as positive, and that students and staff will likely be concerned about learning and working in environments that in some cases will offer little to no physical distance. We know that increases in positive cases will lead to increases in the number of students who will need to quarantine, and the contact tracing efforts of our staff will also increase. And I really want to thank our principals for having some very specific examples today, aligned to all the different kind of considerations and realities when we're talking about moving from potentially 2 to 4 days in our middle and high schools. So considering all of the information that we have shared, we see three viable options for the board to consider at the middle school level. The board had asked for us to have sort of separate conversations and approvals, one for the middle school level and one for the high school level. So we will start with the middle school level. The options that we see as viable would be to remain in our current blended model, to increase to 4 full days of in-person learning, or to consider a reduced daily schedule of 4 days that would avoid the lunch routine that we've kind of been talking about. With respect to the third option, I think we've heard some really good kind of description of what that would all entail. There are some other districts around us who have published a very similar plan for very similar reasons. McFarland, DeForest, and Oregon are all thinking about a reduced daily schedule in middle school and high school. We are recommending that any increases to in-person learning at the middle school level would start on May 3rd, and that is because of the Wisconsin Forward examination schedule that Ken and Don kind of just detailed. So with that, we would welcome certainly any additional board questions.
Yeah, a quick question. Number three, it said that there was an increase in personal learning to 4 half days. How much extra hours or time is there between the blended model that we currently have right now and the half days?
Like a time of instructional time, you mean? It's like we were saying at the high school, it's about the same.
I was just confused by increase in personal learning on option three.
Increase the number of days.
Well, I understand. Right, that's fine. I just saw in personal learning. So basically, it's kind of a wash. It's just whether we do it on a hybrid or what we do on a 4 day.
2 days versus 4 days.
Thank you.
I want to go back to that question about the high school and the construction. How much space do we not have because parts of the building? And I don't need a number, just give your best thumbnail guess.
Sure. I guess first thing I want to say is that Findorf, our construction firm, has been amazing at accommodating. Amazing. And we planned for these constraints in construction all along. What added to it, of course, is the pandemic restrictions and so on. So we know that we're already overcrowded, and basically what it is that we've had to close certain hallways And so the number of students passing in hallways is significantly increased. Mm-hmm. We have reduced access on the north end of the building. We've got, our rooms are filled up, and so we don't have flexibility to, you know, to separate. Our black box, our PAC are used for storage and the classroom. And then really the other thing would be the parking, where we would lose between 200 and 250 student parking spots that we would have to pull back and rescind all of parking and then reissue parking. So those are really the big pieces. It's really the congestion in hallways, the lack of flexibility in any classrooms because we're full to the brim. Just reduced access on the north side.
Thank you.
I have another question about the parking. If we had to rescind 250 parking passes, presumably not every student drives alone. So that would be, 400, 500 students that they would then get kicked into possibly transportation. Would we be able to accommodate that level of transferring students?
Well, I think that we don't know if they would get kicked into transportation,
or probably some,
or what some might, or whether they would look to find parking elsewhere
in the neighborhoods.
I think what I do know from a busing standpoint is that we know that we won't be able to maintain, we'll be able to maintain our mitigation factors in the sense of what we do between routes, wearing masks, doing all those kinds of things. We'll sit siblings together when we can, but we know that we won't be able to ensure the distancing at any level. We might have people who are in non-households sitting in the same seat in order to get all of our students to school. I'm sure that at the high school level, and not as much at the middle level, but at the high school level, we certainly have probably room for some of the kids on the buses. We certainly wouldn't have 400 and some class. But I also don't know that at that level we see them going to a bus. I think we see them looking to park elsewhere.
Okay. Thank you.
Can I ask a question about that, Lori, and anyone else that might have the information? But if they pursue parking in the neighborhood, is that even viable? I know, Paul, you always talk about how the neighborhood is usually very opposed to the additional parking. Is that even possible?
There's areas that require permits, but we already know that there are a number of students who park out beyond the permitted area and then just walk the distance it takes to get into the school. I would expect, and you guys can confirm, I would expect that to increase.
And the parking, for those of you that haven't been there, the parking in the neighborhood is significantly worse right now because we have multiple construction projects going on. It's not just Middleton High School, there's multiple construction projects. So our staff even is parking significantly further away because of all of the construction in the neighborhood.
Other questions?
Oh, I was just gonna ask about Dom and Penn mentioned about having students need to do synchronous work while at school with a supervising teacher. That really seems like that would be a tough sell. I mean, to literally be doing that in the building and having to be probably the only ones that are having to transport their computers to do so. I mean, there'll be a much less probably students having to have their computers charged in with them every day if they're there 4 days a week. And I know that you've certainly thought of every solution under the sun because this is like a tough one. But how many students do you think that that would affect?
For me, we took classes that were 32, I think the largest class is 45. So it's so you'd be about half those kids. And so what we would probably do is half of the students would concurrent Zoom in, and then the other 2 days they would be in person. So they would spend, you know, 2 days Zooming into the class, 2 days having it in person. So I'm probably looking at,
just over 300 for probably. That's on average, because we would only do that with classes that would be over 35. We might have to dip a little bit lower depending on spacing, so it might be classes of 32, 33. But I can guarantee it'll be at least 300 kids who will be on that rotational. Half the time they'll be with their teacher, the other half of the time they'll be with the supervising teacher.
Thank you for clarifying that, because that's actually a much higher number than I was anticipating.
Would that be for all grades?
That'll be mostly 6 through 8. The average class sizes are higher in grades 7 and 8, because we did see the highest fluctuation from universal to fully virtual there. And because that did require staffing changes, we had to resection teachers as opposed to make them fully virtual. So our average class size in 7th grade and 8th grade are on average higher. So we're closer to 30 for 7th and 8th grade. Whereas for primary, I can't speak fully for Glacier, our average for 5th and 6th grade is about 24, 23, with some outliers that are 26, 27.
We're fairly consistent with that. Most of our really large classes are language classes, like I said before. So, primarily Spanish, a few German, and Mandarin classes.
And yours would be about the 300 number as well. That would be in a situation where they would be split and have to be in a different room, they'd be watching on the computer.
And that would be for a period of their day, like during that class. It would not like 300 for all day long.
One class,
yeah,
during the course of the day.
Yeah.
Okay.
Make sure that's clear.
Yeah. I am really, really struggling with this vote. with the plan, with what it would mean to open, with what it would mean to stay in hybrid. When we voted to keep schools closed, we voted based on the recommendations of public health, Madison and County. Then when we voted to keep them closed, move into a hybrid model based on PHMDC, the CDC, our medical advisors that so graciously gave their time to us. And we said we would open in line with the advice of the same groups, and those groups are saying that this can be done safely. Mental health remains a huge concern no matter what happens. At this point, there are going to be parents, students, teachers, staff members who struggle with their mental health with whatever we vote to do today, and that is an enormous burden for every single one of us in this room to sort of sit in the knowledge of. As Vicky Shaver said earlier, some students are thriving, some failing to gain any traction, and everything in between through this hybrid model. That is the truth of the matter, and whatever we choose today is going to be amazing for some students, it's going to be terrible for others. The transmission and safety mitigation procedures, again, as Vicky said, they are designed to make us safer and not to make us safe, and unfortunately that is the world that we live in now and the world that we're going to continue to live in. It's a huge problem. And where I'm really running into trouble is sort of from looking at the dashboard right now with 4 positive cases at the high school and 33 quarantines, which works out about 8.25 close contacts per positive student. And over all time, 63 close contacts from 16 positives, which is just under 4 close contacts per person. So, you look into it and you dig into what's happening or whatever has happened. And, we are, as a society, I wouldn't even say as a district, I would say as a society, we are allowing sports, close contact sports. Some wear masks or not worn for whatever reason. Those students and their parents, we're allowed to choose whether or not they participated in those. But the students who we are planning to be cohorting at the high school, when they are in a class with a student who plays sports, are exposed to every single other one of the students who are playing those sports. It has huge impacts. The sports that we have prioritized as a society over getting kids back into the classroom is causing an enormous problem. And I am not advocating that we don't allow sports to continue, but I am saying that parents and students are given the opportunity to do that and knowing the risks that were associated with it. And I cannot shake the feeling that at this point, as a school district, as people who are in the business of educating students, that we should be giving parents the same choice, understanding the risk associated, but making that decision for their child, because for the exact same reasons that parents were really talking to the staff in the district who were making the decision about sports and coming back into sports, so many were saying it's for their mental health. They cannot handle this. They're gaining weight. They're not active. Their mental health is deteriorating. We are making this choice for our family. It just kind of feels wrong to not then turn that around and do the exact same thing on an educational basis. The construction at the high school throws a huge wrench in the entire process. But I also cannot, I've had conversations, I've really tried to make a point to talk to people in the district and figure out why this, why the half-day model seems like a preference. And it comes down to lunch and the fact that we don't have the ability to really control what happens with the students at lunchtime. And that's really, I don't know what you do about it. I don't know how you fix that. It's a huge and it's an enormous problem. But at the same time, that half-day model is double the exposure for kids to no actual increase in in-person time. Like, yes, they come 4 days, but the gains of the in-person time, there aren't any. There's no gain. There's just more risk. So I'm struggling. I'm sitting here and telling you all of the reasons why I'm finding this decision so incredibly hard. I think that it is reasonable for the taxpayers of our district to say, other districts are doing this. Why can you not do it? And I don't, I'm really struggling to figure out how we sort of reconcile the problems that we're having and the way that we're moving forward. So long story short, don't have any questions, but I'm very, very confused.
I share Katie's struggle with what to do, knowing that there isn't a right or wrong answer. In fact, it's, do you stay on the burning ship or jump into shark infested waters, right? Those are the choices we have. But I do want to suggest a choice. And with respect to the middle school, we know that masking and hand washing is the most important factor in preventing COVID from spreading. And we can do that if we go back to 4 days in the middle school. Other districts have had success going to 4 days a week in their middle school. We have presumably seasonality on our side with respect to spread in the middle schools. As the days get longer and as people just spend more time outside when they're not in school, we're going to see infections drop, presumably. If we really do wait until May 3rd to start, we're going to see a larger number of vaccines in the community. Now, I know that the middle school kids won't be vaccinated, but from what I understand, most of the spread that occurs in schools starts outside of the school. So if there's less virus being transmitted outside of the school, there should be less virus transmitted in the school. By May 3rd, God willing, we will be able to use the outsides much more frequently to further mitigate spread and distance the students. I know that there are different groups of students who benefit from 4 days as opposed to 2 days, but I suspect that the larger group is going to be the group that benefits from being in school 4 days. And even then, I think that there will be some students who are nervous at first, but will overcome that nervousness when they become familiar with going 4 days a week. And it's also only going to be 20 days. 20 days we're talking about here. Now, I know you could flip that around and say, well, it's just 20 days. It's just in 2 days a week. But I really think after this horrific year and after being kept out of even something that's even a semblance of a normal situation, I think it's better to have those 20 days with the kids in school 4 days a week than it is to say, keep them in those 20, just stay with 2 days a week for those last 20 days. I know it's not perfect, but I think it's better. So I'm going to make a motion that the board approve option two to bring back the middle school. High school is a separate discussion. To bring back the middle school 4 days a week starting May 3rd.
Is there a second?
Second. Bob Green.
Is there other questions and discussions? Bob?
If I can impose upon the principal. If you can compress it to 30 seconds to a minute. You know the school, you know the students, you know the teachers, you know the challenges. Given your choice, and we won't hold against you no matter what your choice is, we're just looking for information there. What would you have the board do? Where would you go with your school?
No, it's hard. It's hard and it's easy at the same time. You also gave a recommendation last time. I, like you, like I wear the full weight of everything that's been said so far, and I validate every positive thing about increased learning time. But me as an administrator, the part that continues to put a pit in my stomach as I think about the idea of increasing time is the fact that I know I can't guarantee social distancing when kids are eating. So for me, I enjoy, from a leadership standpoint, the idea that I know I can make sure that there's no close contact in my building if we stay the course for the rest of the time. There's more uncertainty involved. And of course, no risk, there's no reward. So I understand what's at stake and I fully support whatever decision you do moving forward. We're gonna work together to make sure that it's quality work no matter what. My recommendation still remains hybrid. Knowing full well, I will support whatever decision that you make.
Well, I think Lindsay, you were.
No.
Okay. I'm kind of with Paul here and Katie's. I struggle here with the mixed messages that we're receiving in terms of safety and interest, sports, blah, 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 blah. What I'm going back to and thinking about is one of my first concerns, and that is getting teachers and staff vaccinated. To me, now that we're on that path, and hopefully onto the path by the time we're looking at these dates where we would make a change, perhaps you can tell me, Dana, with, can't give exact answers, but you know, we would have people who would be getting their second shots and then would have the ability to, you know, of 2 weeks after that one. Would the dates that we're looking at right now, would we have most of our staff, if not all of our staff? I know it's not a question to answer because it's specific concerns and such as that.
Sure. So we believe the vast majority of our staff who've been offered a vaccination have taken advantage of that. And with the timelines and what we've heard from medical advisors about how many days it takes for that vaccination to be free to be considered fully vaccinated, May 3rd, we'd be in good stead. I'm just looking at Danielle and more of the confirmation, but we believe that that would be the case.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
I am struggling too with this decision. And as Paul had mentioned, it is 20 days, but it's only 20 days. It's almost end of the year. And I believe that we should stay strong and start strong for fall, bringing everyone together. rather than making changes, which we have done all year long on the teachers, on the students. And I keep saying this over and over, I commend these children. The changes they've been through, these little learners up to high schoolers, it's hard. It's hard on us adults. It's even more harder on them. I would like to also say that as Dom and Kent are saying that lunch is a big issue and it's scary. I think, in my opinion, I would feel safe in order for our students to go back to school in a normal way. If for this year, I would like to make a motion for 4 half days, not full days, so that they don't have to have lunch. And come back home, have lunch, and do the asynchronous learning after when they get home, so that our educators, our administrators, even in school, don't have to go through that stress level. That's what I think.
And I think because there is a motion on the table right now, we would have to go through the process of voting before you could make another motion, Linda. So
okay.
That's
my recommendation.
The process we need to go through. Pat?
Yeah, at this point I don't have a lot to add. I don't think it advances the ball to talk about how hard this is, because everyone in this room has lost a lot of sleep over this, including me, of course. So I'm very uncomfortable with the lack of distancing and ability to distance, but you know, we tried to follow the advice of our medical experts throughout this process, and they're indicating it's less of a concern at this stage of the year. You know, I fully understand the burdens on everybody. You've done a great job of outlining that, and you know, we humbly acknowledge, you know, your presentation, your recommendations, and feeling. You know, it's not ideal for anyone. You know, the burning ship in those shark infested waters, I certainly understand that. And there's just simply no way to address every issue. The only other thing that I wanted to add for my support for the 4 days is I just think it will help the process of the fall, that we don't get back to the fall without having a greater, you know, kids in school in the classrooms more often. I think it will help with that transition. That's a little bit, one more step towards normalcy, I guess, with that. So, yeah, I appreciate all the thoughts and the you know, sincere thought. I mean, we're doing our best. And so I really do appreciate the presentation that I had supported the 4 days from high school.
I would like to add, to Dom and Ken, you know, also very, very much understand the concerns about lunchtime. And I think that as a board, if we choose to pass a measure that involves students being at school during lunchtime, that it would be incumbent upon us to facilitate getting extra space, you know, amending budgets in whatever way necessary to get tents or to get whatever it is that we need to get in place that relieves that burden from you, because obviously that's enormous. It's enormous for you, it's enormous for the students, it's enormous for your staff. It would be remiss of us to suggest that we would vote to approve something that is not fixable, that we could not do something about. I would say that if we were to pass that it would be imperative that we work together to make sure that whatever you need, we get.
I like the idea, but I guess I'm speaking against it as it stands now, because I don't think unless our superintendent can say, oh, we can definitely get space, so all middle school students will have extra space somewhere to have lunch, because the CDC has said one of the greatest areas of danger, and others have done it, if you look at research they've been talking about at the weekend, is that lunchtime is not only a danger for students, for increased risk of exchanging COVID, but also for educators and staff. That's been very, very clear. And I'd have a hard time voting for the motion as it stands right now, unless I don't want to have this thing like, we encourage the district to find more space for middle school students to have lunch in a safe safe environment, because how do we know you can? You know?
Well, the things that we've talked about with the middle school folks would be the purchasing of tents to be put outside. I think, as we've mentioned, primarily the space, the outdoor space here is limited as compared to Glacier. So we would have to kind of impinge on parking lot space for that. And weather permitting, now May 3rd, the likelihood of it being nicer than in April is good. But weather permitting, you'd be able to purchase a rent tent. The price is about the same. And that would be the way that we could expand space for lunches to happen.
Can I ask a question? Would that also potentially, could that be more space to hold some of those larger classes to eliminate the need to separate them and have two separate people meet? Is that?
No, most likely no. We wouldn't have Wi-Fi capabilities out there that would be able to handle that level of load.
Okay. And the other thing I wanted to just double check again, we've established that by May 3rd, when we're talking about this, the educators should all be fully vaccinated, and the period of time to actually have the vaccination be effective would be provided. Okay. Any other questions? All right, are we ready to vote? I'll do a roll call vote.
You want to repeat the motion?
Yes, please. Oh, yes. So we have a motion made by Paul, seconded by Bob, which is recommendation number 2, to increase in-person learning to 4 full days a week at the middle school only. Paul, did I get that?
That's correct.
Okay. So are we all ready? Anne?
No.
Sean?
Aye.
Bob Green?
Aye.
Linda Green?
No.
Katie Morgan?
Aye.
Pat Smith?
Aye.
Bob Hesselbein?
Aye.
Paul Kinney?
Aye.
And I am an aye as well. What's that? 7-2. Okay. Yeah. Okay, and then I think we go into the rest of the slide presentation.
Actually, I think we covered the only other slide we had. It was just more information on the construction at the high school, and Peg has provided that information. And so same process would be if there's any additional questions or comments from the board before you take action at the high school level.
Seeing the construction going on and the limited space that exists within the high school, I move that we continue to maintain a blended model of the high school through the remainder of the year.
Second, Bob. Questions, discussion.
So I took the time to visit the high school on Friday. To walk around the buildings and or the building and observe the hallways. And I walked past, I stayed until the classes started. And I walked around and looked inside the classrooms and imagined that there were twice as many kids in those classrooms. And, you know, some classrooms would be full and the kids would be very close to one another. Some classes, they'd be like literally side by side, as they are in a normal classroom. So it's not, you know, it was a pretty vivid, you know, illustration for me of the limitations of that building. And with all the additional concerns added by construction, you know, I do think it's a different set of circumstances than I presented at the middle school. Couldn't we do it? I mean, I think we can, but I don't know that 4 days a week is that even really on the table for, you know, returning 4 days, full days for the high school. It's not one of our options.
Right. When we talk yeah. about it as an administrative team, I think that the realities around the lunch schedule and just the data that Peg said with regard to in an inclement weather when we wouldn't be able to be outside with tents and things like that, there simply aren't spaces for kids to eat, and we just couldn't get past that.
Yeah, and I don't see the benefits of the half day model. It's just the whole, for me, everybody has their own ideas, but the whole point is getting kids back into class. And if we don't, more often, if we don't get that benefit, I can't imagine disrupting everybody and everything that would go along, all of the very serious consequences of that. So I don't see that. So if our choices are the 4-day, half day model or remaining as it is, I'm leaning towards remaining as we are in the current hybrid model for the high school.
I'm going to echo that as well. The high school is certainly a different situation. The questions that we're going to be asked by the public will be, how come you didn't go to a 4-day model while the other districts are going to a 4-day model? I think the question is answered by the unique situation we're in right now with construction. The ability to flex and move around is extremely limited right now due to the construction issues, the hallways, the higher potential for potential contamination, probably the wrong word, but because of the increased contact with students as they're transitioning from point A to point B. I do struggle with the sports aspect. It is a concern for me that we do allow sports and contact to occur. We kind of send a mixed message there, but I can't get around the construction aspects and the issues that we have in our school right now, which would make us different from the surrounding high schools in our area. So again, I would echo Todd's concern as well.
I'm gonna ask a question, and you may be the person to answer, but when we've been hearing this from our parents, what is different in the fall that isn't the same right now? For instance, we've said we want to go back full time in person, 5 days a week in the fall. And we hear from a lot of our parents in our community that say, you've made that commitment, what's different then that we don't have now? And I think this is a good venue to address that. And I want to hear from those of you that are experts on it.
I think you've mentioned before, there's a high likelihood that our high school students will be vaccinated by the fall, which just adds another layer of assurance and protection for kids and adults alike. More of the general population will be vaccinated also. So the data in Dane County certainly is going in the right direction, and we're so encouraged and we're hopeful that continues. And so the combination of the additional vaccinations and low community spread just gives us confidence in our ability to be able to be in person with our largest, particularly at MHS, our largest building, with our biggest kids, having that vaccination protection will be really, really important. There's also been a lot of kind of comparison between other high schools. And I'll just take Verona High School as an example. They have a brand new facility that is a really, really big school. They have more kids in their fully virtual program. And so they're able to really, at this point in the spring, be very creative and spread out across the building. We just don't have that ability. Next year, when the north side addition is open and we're able to migrate into that space, I don't have a square footage comparison, maybe you do, Peg, but I believe that our ability to be even more creative with space in the fall will be there because of that three-story addition.
Absolutely, we'll have small group instruction spaces, we'll have more open common spaces, just much more opportunity to be flexible in terms of seating and classes and so on that we have now.
I think instructionally the other big piece, we have made so many transitions this year. The good news in that is we have learned a lot. And I think by next fall, we will be in a very good position to be able to offer options that we can stick with for families that will offer the flexibility that if we had known we were going to be in this position for an entire year, we would have been able to foresee. But this has been something that's been such a slow rollout and so many changes. I think we will be in very good shape to be able to offer options to families next year and have them all be quality options.
What I'm I'm going somewhere, I promise. Okay. What protection? So my immediate reaction is, you know, like I said earlier, we are in a situation where the vote that we made to stay virtual and then the vote we made to be hybrid was based on the recommendations that we had. Those recommendations have changed. We could, as a board, choose to say that, you know, everyone goes back 4 days, and it wouldn't be unreasonable for us to do so. However, clearly we have this big problem of space at the high school, which obviously is being addressed by, you know, creating a new building. We were crunched before the pandemic, let alone now. Puts Middleton Cross Point School District in a really sticky position for handling a pandemic. However, we do still have this problem of, you know, the idea of cohorting at the high school being a complete fallacy because of the sports that we have. So what can we do to protect the students in each cohort from the spread that is happening as a result of sports and that mixing within the cohort? So what can we do to, if we're going to say now, well, we're going to keep this blended model, or we're going to through these 4 half days, which I would also advocate against simply because I don't think it adds any real benefit to the situation. What do we do to protect the students who want to come into school to learn from the students whose parents and themselves have made the choice, rightfully so, that they want to do sports? That's really sitting heavily with me.
You know, been speaking, and Peggy can chime in here too, speaking with our athletic director, Jamie Sims, as of late. He continues to monitor practices, competitions. He's having coaching meetings. He sent messages most recently to families and to students about the importance of adherence to all the protocols. And so we'll continue to do that messaging. The high school really is not cohorted. We have a 1,000 kid cohort one and 1,000 kid cohort two. And of course, you know, athletes are intermingled. We'll continue to do the contact tracing and, you know, be on top of that as much as we can so that we, you know, mitigate any kind of spread. And that's probably the best that we can do at this point. I'm okay if there's anything else you would add to that.
We know where kids are sitting on buses. We know, you know, I mean, all of those kinds of things are variables that we do know. But beyond that, I completely understand the sort of conflict it brings up.
Well, I think part of the messaging is to our community that, you know, our community needs to really remain vigilant about this as well. Wasn't one of the sports incidences from someone that was fully virtual? So they're obviously not catching it at school. So again,
well, it might be if we participate in sports, we might be other stuff. That is a school.
It could be in a game situation, competition situation. Yeah. So, you know, it's just we can't just think that it's over completely. The numbers are low, but it's still out there, obviously. So,
the numbers are low only because of all the different disciplines we've taken. Every single step that you throughout the community are all factors in getting our numbers low. As we begin to pull out those plugs, we can see the elements go. And what's happening in Europe, wave 3, is coming here. Mm-hmm. We will see wave 3, and it's a race between vaccines and wave 3. And I wish I could put it on a chart. We're looking at the intersecting line. Does vaccine stop it at where? Where does vaccine stop it? In other words, remember the vaccine only keeps your body from reacting to the COVID-19 that you inject. You don't get the runny nose. You don't get the fever because our body doesn't respond. The people dying of COVID-19, except for those who die in the vascular model, are dying because they've overreacted. So those of us who have our vaccine, if we're exposed to COVID, we will carry it within us and it'll replicate within us, but we just won't get sick from it. And everything that we take away from those walls is going to keep COVID-19 in the community until we're all vaccinated and it passes away, unless it morphs. And that's our big fear. I'm sorry, that's just a little nutshell, but when we ask why we're doing these things, that's kind of why. We're here because of all the things we've done, not because it's gone away in itself.
And perhaps I could just piggyback on that. Perhaps an easier way to understand it is we're just increasing the pool, potential pool for asymptomatic carriers of COVID-19. We're not eliminating the ability for the disease to be transmitted. We're just increasing the potential pool for people who are asymptomatic.
Correct. Yeah.
Which would go back to my, I know my biggest concern was staff and employees being vaccinated, so at least the long-term implications of more serious implications would be, you know, into the more of an asymptomatic type situation. So now we're more likely dealing with students as an issue and people who choose not to get vaccinated. But again, hoping that curve, like you said,
where do they meet?
Where do they meet? Thank you.
Any other questions, comments? All right, so we have a motion from Bob Hasselbein to maintain high school students in a blended model through the end of the school year, and was the second with Ann Bauer. Are we ready to vote? I want to make sure. I'm going to start with you, Ann. Yes. Sean?
Aye.
Bob Green?
Aye.
Linda Green?
Aye.
Katie Morgan?
Aye.
Todd Smith?
Aye.
Bob Hasselbein?
Aye.
Paul Keating?
Aye.
And I am an aye as well. So that passed unanimously. I want to thank all of you for coming. The presentation tonight was fabulous. I can tell that you have put so much work into it. Great job with coordinating your work and just informing us of all of the factors that we needed to think about. So we appreciate that.
I want to thank the initiative team and the board for just a really thoughtful, cordial dialogue and discourse on a really complex and difficult issue. So we thank you for your questions and your recommendations. And I know that the team will take that forward at the middle school as we look to implement 4 days of in-person learning and as we continue in the blended model at our high school campus.
I especially want to say thank you to the two of you. I know it's cold comfort for us to sit here and say this is a hard decision for us because you've got to do it, right? So, but I really appreciate your professionalism and your positive attitude, and I know you can do it, I know we can do it. So thank you very, very much on my behalf, and on behalf, I'm sure, of the community.
Thank you. Absolutely. All right. Thanks again for being here.
You could feel free. You have long days already, so if you wanna head out, feel free. And again, this will appreciate your time tonight. Okay, so next on our agenda is the topic of returning to in-person board meetings at the District Services Center. We have moved our meetings here because we wanted a larger space. It was suggested now since the changes in spacing and everything that we would move back to the District Service Center. We presently broadcast the meetings using YouTube Live, so the community has access to meetings in real time. So I wanted to throw that out as a question as to, would we maintain that to allow access and be able to continue so the community has a way to access the meetings. And that discussion points to Sean.
Yeah, I would just say similar to when we talked about bringing kids back to school, we advocated to have the board come back to in-person meetings. I would advocate that we return to the district center, even if there is a little less space between.
Okay.
Yeah, the question that I had on this, I think I was the person who actually was requesting this, was by going back to in-person meetings, would we need the ability to participate via Zoom or just go back to having YouTube and having it broadcasted the way we used to do it in the past? And then encouraging public to make their comments in public at our meetings. You know, we could certainly provide a safe way to do that. Not much different than what we're doing here, but then also have the ability, if people wanted to attend the meeting, they could sit, you know, in the back as well, or we could find a way to broadcast it to a different room. But we're talking about normalizing the school district in the terms of the way we do things. And we certainly should be leading by example. We're asking our teachers and our staff to do it. So I think that would be another part of this discussion, is whether we would do Zoom anymore and just start returning to just basically in person.
I have the same question as Bob. If Zooming would be allowed, if public is allowed to come and put their comments just the way it used to be. Same thing is not about.
So I have some feelings about this, especially about Zoom. And number one, I have no problem going back to the district service center. I don't see any problem with that at all. Number two, I think one of the good things to come out of the pandemic is that we've been able to really sit back and take stock and look at how we have done things in the past and how we want to do things in the future. I don't see any reason why we wouldn't continue to broadcast on YouTube Live. I think that is a really good way of engaging the community. And in the same way, I don't see any reason why we shouldn't continue to use Zoom. If the board members number one, we offer a fully virtual option for our students, because some families still do not feel comfortable, and to take away the opportunity for those families to participate via Zoom seems inappropriate at this point in time. But also the ability for people to join via Zoom on an ongoing fashion feels really like an equitable move for the board to do, you know, to enable single parents who don't have a babysitter to still participate and to still make comments by Zooming in. That seems like a great thing to enable, you know, somebody who lives, you know, furthest away that you can get from the district service center, and it would be, you know, a huge problem for them to leave work or work shifts or whatever else to engage with us via Zoom seems like a good thing. You know, returning to normal doesn't mean going back to how we used to do things. It means figuring out what new normal is, and that would be my recommendation, is that we use some of these really cool things that have been developed throughout this pandemic to make us more accessible.
So the Zoom linkage that you're referring to is in connection with the comments portion, which is where we allow in-person comments by Zoom or written comments.
Yes. Okay. And I would also say that until such time as, you know, we're confident that the pandemic is over and nobody has to quarantine anymore, that we should be available, you know, we should maybe be able to make use of that as board members too, because if we cannot vote on something because we are quarantined due to a close contact rather than actually having it, that would be so frustrating. You know, we want to be as good representatives as we were elected to be. And yeah.
Okay, and then one, did you have any other questions?
I did, I don't know, I was trying to. I agree. I just think that it's important to be accessible going forward. I think it'll be good for our reputation of the community to be able to be reached and accessed multiple different ways. And hey, the world is, I mean, you know, I go to court via Zoom now, everybody is comfortable with it. It's not unusual or different or strange to allow someone to talk to you via Zoom. That's the way the world now. So I appreciate a lot.
And then one more,
And just one more thing to add to it. If we're talking about, you know, keeping this as a technology going forward, I think that we need to also maintain the technology in the classroom, because you're gonna have kids that are sick. We've already got the infrastructure in place. Why not have kids continue to be in school even if they're at home?
And we have an instructional design team that is meeting right now about next year and talking about exactly that, how to continue to leverage technology for as many ways as you can with kids.
Right, just keep it going.
Yeah.
kind of feel like this is a decision for a future board since three of us are.
And then actually, I can piggyback on that. It would actually be a decision for a future board because currently we have a board. We passed a measure that stated as long as we're under an emergency order through Dane County, that board members are allowed to attend via Zoom. The minute we're no longer under a public health order, then that would eliminate that at that time.
Mm-hmm.
So unless that happens in the near future, we're probably going to stay under this unless we put it as an action item to repeal that. So under this particular time, I was asking more of a question, just, you know, as we move forward, and I agree with everybody. I think we should maintain the Zoom, but it needed to be something different because it would be on the public comment section. And that is separate. The board has the ability to do public comment either via Zoom or via in person, but it does need to be a decision by the board and said and then be consistently followed. So I think we're all kind of saying the same thing here.
But I guess there's no problem tonight voting to see if we go back to the DSC.
Right.
You're right.
Yeah, well, we can leave that for later.
Right.
That's the only thing that's on the agenda.
That's the only thing that's on there. But just Zoom would have been a part of that going back to the DSC.
But I do want to ask though, if we go back to the DSC and people come in to make comments, are we going to allow them to stay and watch the meeting if they wish, or people from the public coming in to watch the meeting? Here we haven't done that. Is that, I mean, and are we under space restrictions as a result of the health order? I'm not sure.
We have to check that. I know that there is space, not a lot of space, certainly for people to remain. We had talked about the setup is very similar to this one where people could come into the boardroom, make a comment, and then exit out the side door, and that would work very well and mimic what's happening here. I don't think we'd be able to accommodate many observers, especially if we continue to have a handful of administrators who are attending meetings every, you know, meeting to share insights that probably isn't a whole lot of space for people to watch.
Okay, and I saw hands up over here. That also was there hands up, Linda?
I actually wanted to copy what Dana has just said. I think the most comfortable part would be let people come, put their comments, leave, and watch over YouTube. That would be my recommendation.
Okay, Bob?
If we're unsure about space and these type of questions that are all good questions are being asked tonight, I'm not uncomfortable being here if it's not too difficult for the staff to set up the room for board meetings. Is there a tremendous rush to get back there to the DSC?
Well, the reason I brought up is the audiovisual capabilities at the DSC are superior to what we have.
The room is smaller, and so the OWL will likely provide a better audio quality for people who are watching on YouTube.
So the big reason to go back is this little OWL right here. Just so we're clear on that.
Yeah, this sound would be better because the size of the room would pick up better on this.
So we've got a great setup here space-wise during COVID. I mean, plenty of space.
Are you getting a lot of feedback that people are having difficulty hearing?
Perry, I would be the person who gets the most feedback.
The answer to that, Vincent, is yes. The reality is that's why that data continue to remind everybody about projecting, about speaking more slowly. The masks don't help any of us. We all know that. But I think also what we're now finding, everyone, is that so tonight, for example, at our peak, we had 273 people watching live on YouTube. For those of you who've been on the board for a while, I don't know that we ever had 273 people. So I mean, it's sort of a new expectation, but certainly if we can do things to make the audio better, we want to do that.
Do our microphones not work with the OWL, the ones that we had at the DSC?
No, those
you need a mixer.
For recording purposes. Oh, they're not to amplify your voice.
You need a soundboard to take the sound, take the 9 to 10 to 11 things, bring it down into one channel, then output it back out and mix it with the video.
Mm-hmm.
Is that correct?
Yes.
Pretty close, yeah. Remember when we had the microphones, and this is not for them, it's just reality. You know, there were times if you turned away and were talking to, you know, you weren't talking directly into the microphones, that it was hard for people to hear that the next day when they were watching, because after Cheryl uploaded it. So this is nothing new. Audio doesn't always work great regardless of what you need, so.
So I think, just judging from what I've heard, let's go back to the DSC. I've also heard this gives us more space. If people can talk louder, we could stay here. What does everybody think? What's on your mind?
I don't have a problem going back to DSC if, you know, space is not the issue, and if we are not allowing the whole public to come, I don't have a problem to go back there.
I think we're the next board that three of us are going to have to.
So should we table this until
May
when we, I'm just throwing it out so someone can make a motion.
So,
Paul,
you're so good.
I make a motion to table the decision to let the next board decide. I'll speak for myself. I haven't been vaccinated yet. Give a little more time and we'll all be vaccinated too. Yeah. And that closer quarters will be less of a threat. So my motion is to table this until the next
second.
All right, let's do a voice vote.
And
our one, just to give you a reminder, our next meeting, April 12th at 5:30, we have agenda setting. At 6 o'clock, we have finance. And at 7 o'clock, we have the regular board meeting. Does anyone have topics they would like to suggest for agenda? Katie?
I would like to talk about mental health supports for the fall, for students and staff.
And Linda, I saw your hand up.
Yes, I think we should talk about more substitute issue that we were having, the schools are facing.
We can include data. We get a weekly report of some fill rates, so we have information we can share.
Thank you.
And I'd love it if the new board would consider ways to talk to teachers to learn what they learned from this year and how they can use technology with students. And what they learned about, you know, just what they learned from this year, what lessons can be drawn over the summer that may or may not be implemented next academic year. The summer is a good time. I think the teachers probably have a wealth of good suggestions and ideas in that regard.
Yeah, this came up during the same session, just information about summer school.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that is coming forward, Sherry Wendt. People anything else that you want to suggest? All right, can I get a motion to adjourn?
Second.
Okay, our board votes. Ann Rauner, aye. Sean Hyland,
aye.
Bob Green,
aye.
Linda, aye. Dave Morgan,
aye.
Kevin,
aye.
Bob Huckleberry,
aye.
I'm an aye as well.